In just 6 years, the Everest has gone from being an idea to the greatest sprint race in the world.
Yes, yes, yes!
Five fast winners, each of them as rapid as they come, smashing the clock, while the day smashes expectations of what a race day can be, even with a sprinkling of Sweet Caroline. Time flies when you're having fun. Welcome to the Everest Show, Episode 3. Take it away, team.
Oh, thanks, George, and I'm really hoping I can get a Sweet Caroline out of these two before the big race in about 9 days' time. The countdown is well and truly on, and I'm joined by two of the best in the business too for this week's show. Brennan Popwell, Guy Havelt, a very warm welcome. I guess before we talk all things Everest, Imperatrice is a really good starting point because she was electric on Friday night. Love taking that Australian money back to New Zealand.
And she's done it twice in a row at Moonee Valley, hasn't she? We saw her the first time and we thought, wow, can she do that again? And she absolutely did. Sits at the back and just blasts straight past them. I don't know about you, BP, but it was so good that I didn't get a lot of sleep after that.
No, it was pretty hard to get some sleep after that, to be honest with you, Guy. And look, she was just incredible. I mean, she's backed up what she's been able to do. She breaks her own track record and she just blows them away. She is an elite sprinter from both sides of the Tasman because she's shown it here. She won those five Group 1s in the last couple of seasons, of course, picking up a victory last season in Melbourne. And now the potential that she could be better than those last couple of seasons is actually mind-blowing. She is an incredible horse and can't wait to see what she can do in those next couple of starts in Melbourne.
Yeah, couldn't have said it better myself. Well, we're stepping it up a notch this week. We're digging deeper and we're sinking our teeth into all things Everest. What's coming up on the show? Well, we've got news for you. Plenty has been happening when it comes to slots being filled in the Everest market. We've also dig a little deeper into sectionals and what they mean for our races. We meet Luke Nolan, who is our jockey aboard the Kiwi Star I Wish I Win. Emily and Guy, we get out on the Tamatamata, don't we? We have a lot of fun with the ACC and the pressures on Brendan Popwell. BP's best bets. He got us home in front last week and we are hoping he's got some good tips for us again this week. Brendan, we start with the news and a good starting point is think about it, isn't it? Adds another one to the form record.
He does. We mentioned him last week with how he is coming into the Everest as one of the favourites for the race. And he basically nailed that down with what he did here last week. Premier Stakes, good form reference leading into the Everest. He won by a small margin, but he got the job done.
We need to start calling him the picket fence, I think, instead of think about it, because he's just that good. Joe Pride as well, two in the race.
Yeah, very hard to do that. Aquis, they've secured their slot with Hawaii 5-0.
Yeah, and this is a runner that was beaten by Think About It last season when running third in the Stradbroke Handicap. Very good. Strong sectionals through the line. He was really finishing hard at Think About It. He's the right horse to say that he can be a big chance coming into the Everest. And James McDonald's aboard.
And James McDonald has won this race before, and he's won plenty of other big races as well, so that's no doubt a massive positive.
Yeah, he's used to high pressure, isn't he? Shinzo for Coolmore, they've got one of their own.
They have, yes, their own horse for the slot coming up with Shinzo. A horse who trialled up on Tuesday. Look, he wasn't at his best in the Golden Rose. He is a Golden Slipper winner, and if he can rediscover his best form, he could be a chance at maybe some bigger odds in the race.
And finally, Kiwi Chris Waller, who's won the Everest a couple of times, he's decided to put Espiona in his slot.
That's right. This is the horse after the win in the Golden Pennant Group 2. Still does a few things wrong. Is a Group 1 winner over 1,500 metres in a Coolmore Classic. Chris Waller has decided to roll the dice with her as his runner in the Everest.
Here's an overview of the slot holders and the runners, and they're pretty much all full, aren't they? Apart from that one at the bottom, Yulong Investments.
Yeah.
There's a chance. Hang on. Are you telling me there's a chance that Imperatrice maybe can still make it into the Everest?
Oh, look, I guess because they haven't got a horse, it's a chance for sure. Alcohol Free is their horse. It ran in the Premier Stakes. I know that horse is a possibility for them, but yeah, there's a small chance maybe that Imperatrice, even though we've just spoken about, is going to Melbourne, could be picked up by Yulong. But yeah, I'm sure they'll find that right option and it'll come out in the next couple of days, which way Yulong Investments goes for the Everest. What we do know, though, is Trackside Media has got the slot with I Wish I Win. And not too long ago, Peter Moody was able to give us this update around I Wish I Win.
Morning, Tracksiders. Mood's here at Pakenham Racecourse with I Wish I Win.
10 more sleeps to go. He's in great order, the gelding. He had a nice gallop on Tuesday morning here on the course proper at Pakenham. It was a nice piece of work and pulled up and recovered very nicely from it. So he's just had the dentist visit him. He just had his teeth had a little rub up. Farrie has checked him over, so we don't have to mess around with his feet next week. And we're really pleased with where we're at and the way he's building towards this race. So happy days. He's on the road to Sydney late next week. And let's hope he can fly the flag for all of us. Hello. G'day, mate. That's I wish I win at Pakenham, set and ready for the Everest. Hand it back to you lads in the studio.
Back to you lads in the studio. What about the ladies, Peter? He's forgotten about me, hasn't he?
That's all right. We'll never forget about you, Emily.
Okay, thank you. What we do glean from that little snippet is that he's pretty happy with I wish I win. Would that be the general consensus?
I think so. Look, we've said it beforehand, and Moody, we trust and we have to, don't we, with this preparation with I wish I win. A first up run in the Memsey, I think they got a lot from that run, didn't they? A horse who drew inside was able to finish strongly late in that race, an exhibition gallop a couple of weeks ago, and his equal favourite at $4.50. Think about it, a deserved horse to be at that top of the market too, with the winning strike rate from that runner, only missing once in 11 starts in a first up win in the Premier Stakes. Private Eye placed last year has to be a hope. And then I think you look towards those horses like Cylinder, Hawaii 5-0. Look, even Espiona, if the race is run correctly for it, at $15, as I said beforehand, it's a runner that's been able to win a Group 1 over 1,500 metres, so maybe a race like the Everest running very hard could be playing into that horse's hands as well.
Good stuff. We'll be updating you on that market next week too. Well, if you're like us, you're chomping at the bit to watch the Everest in just 9 days' time. Where are you going to get the best coverage? Well, it's going to be on Trackside Premier. Loads of exclusive content. We're going to be covering the best of the best on that Saturday. Randwick, Caulfield, Hastings, lots of extra features. And it really is Trackside Premier for a reason, because it is premier coverage. Myself and the legendary George Simon will be hosting that. We'll be bouncing around the country to some of the best teams, and of course across the ditch as well, to take in all of the action. It is super exciting, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it's amazing what we're going to be able to do there with that premier coverage. And what about getting George Simon in here as well? the man that was able to kick it all off in terms of Action TV, Trackside TV, along with him and Karen. So I think that's pretty special to get George here as well.
I'll make sure he brings the bags of lollies for you, don't worry.
Thank you. I'll need those. I'm going to be pretty lucky that Saturday, aren't I? Well, we promised you we were going to dig deeper into sectionals and what they mean. Here's a little explainer for you.
Finding the winners of races is the perfect puzzle. How fast a horse can run for how long is just one element in this glorious conundrum. To help assess the speed of our horses, races are broken down into 200 metre sections to give an overview of how the race was run. An even pace for running 200 metres is around 12 seconds. If you're running 13 seconds, while the other horses are running 12, you'll have around 6 lengths to make up.
Conquers another mountain, his second Darley.
Our Everest horses are elite sprinters. They'll be hitting speeds above 60 k's an hour to break 11 seconds for that sectional. The wonderful unbeaten Black Caviar, trained and ridden by our very own Peter Moody and Luke Nolan, is the first horse to break the elusive 10 seconds, clocking 9.98.
And she smashed the course record that many thought would never be broken. Could she possibly be better than she was before? If the numbers tell you, she probably is.
Key takeouts: horses are fast, the clock counts. Use your gas wisely.
Fascinating stuff, and so important to the overall result of the race. Brendan, I want to know more. Can we dig deeper?
Well, there's a number of different variables to a race, and I think one race that we can use is the 2021 Everest, where we've got an on-speed horse and the eventual winner of the race, and that being Nature Strip, and a backmarker, an off-speed runner in Mask Crusader, who finishes into second position. So let's break it down into those 200 metre sectionals we spoke in the explainer. Look at the start of the race. Mask Crusader slow away. He runs his first 200 metres in 14.08. We Nature Strip, he's naturally a horse who likes to put himself there. He runs 13.38 for the first 200. This is where he gets quick. He runs the fastest 200 metre sectional for him in this race, where he runs 10.3 Masked Crusader is starting to build himself. He breaks 11 seconds. He's 10.57 into this next 200 metres. This part's interesting as well as we come up to the next 200 metres from the 8 to the 6. Nature Strip, he's got the pedal down. He's 10.55. Masked Crusader's 10.63. But look at the difference. He's still 9 lengths off Nature Strip. So James McDonald, how hard has he gone? Has he gone too hard in this first half of the race where it could be terminal at the end of the race? Because now we see both of these horses running similar sectionals. Nature Strip, 10.94, 10.95 for Masked Crusader. So Masked Crusader has now gone a quicker sectional in this part of the race than Nature Strip. He's 11.34. He's starting to decrease, but he has an advantage on the rest of the field where Masked Crusader is weaving. Masked Crusader gets out now. He's 11.84. Nature Strip, he's done. Was that first half of the race terminal? No, it wasn't. James McDonald was able to get it bang on right. He wins the race and holds out that late challenge for Masked Crusader, who runs a quick sectional home, but unfortunately doesn't win the race.
And I guess the really interesting point to take away from that is, Guy, is that the jockeys are doing that on field. They don't have a stopwatch. They've not got anything to reference time. It's all based on the feel the horse is giving them.
It's staggering what goes through their heads throughout that race. There's not really any sport, I don't think, where sectionals are made so public in terms of human sports anyway, but you can still marry it up to human sports. I would say that someone like Dame Lisa Carrington is very much like the Nature Strip of her sporting world, in the sense that she gets out very fast, and for her it's just a matter of holding on, which she does obviously very easily and very well. Whereas Masked Crusader, you can probably marry it up to two different examples, one being Usain Bolt. Bigger man, so slower out of the blocks, gets him a little while to get going. Once he gets going, though, he is all power, all speed. And then if you go all the way back to 2008, someone who New Zealanders would know very well, Nick Willis, in that 1500 metres final, he was kind of the Masked Crusader as well. Sat at the back for the first couple of laps, didn't really feature in the race, and then made his move in that last lap. Like Masked Crusader, didn't win the race, but still got bronze, eventually upgraded to silver, and similar sort of race pattern.
Good stuff. Brendan, I guess I wish I win as the backmarker in the upcoming Everest in 9 days' time. Who do you think is going to set up the speed?
Yeah, I think it's going to be a horse like Overpass. That's a horse we're going to be looking to be that Nature Strip sort of horse in this race. Cylinder, a three-year-old, he can naturally put himself there. They're running for $20 million. They're going to be sitting up on speed and running hard. So those backmarkers are going to get that pressure in the race and hopefully that right sort of pressure. And it's not just I Wish I Win. It's horses like Private Eye that will appreciate that sort of tempo, Hawaii 5-0. So they're the runners that will be loving a hot 1,200 metres so they can finish over the top. So, look, some incredible elements to the race, and I just can't wait for it.
Yeah, and we'll be getting into more detail about that next week. Luke Nolan is the man in charge of guiding I Wish I Win to victory. Let's find out a little bit more about him.
She's as rough as a stocko bathtub. She might be a bit of an eyesore, but she's got plenty of character, and that's what I like it the most about it.
The little Minnie, she's a beauty, but it just reminds me of where we've come from a little bit, you know. I was born in a place called Menangatang. It's about 60 miles northwest of Swan Hill, and there's not much there. It was nomadic growing up. Oh man, looking for work and stuff like that. Didn't have a lot, but we didn't miss out on anything. I had a wonderful childhood and helped shape the person I am today. Family's very important. This is why I do what I do. I've got 10 acres here, and I've got a very understanding and beautiful wife, and she gets out and does a bit. I bred two staff, and they haven't quite got involved, me son and me daughter. We bought this place probably 12 years ago, and it really does suit me, this little place.
Go. Yeah,
it's been the best thing we ever did. I got into racing because I hated school more than anything. I was reasonably successful as an apprentice. I won a city title, and then opportunities sort of dried up. I probably lacked the motivation or the drive when it got a bit hard. There was a light bulb moment for me where I said, it's time to pull your finger out and have a crack, or you forget about it and go and do something else. It took probably 2 years of pretty hard work, and then a lifeline for Peter Moody to sort of see things really snowball. But not many of us are lucky enough to go downhill and come back up the other side, and I'm pleased to say I was. Riding for Pete, we just gelled from day one. And I think it's because we're probably both sort of knockabout Aussie bush battling sort of fellas. over 850 winners together. It's a career for a lot of people, and to do it with one bloke, it's pretty bloody special.
This is brutal power wrapped in an elegant machine, and Black Caviar strides away to win it.
Black Caviar, the easiest thing about her was riding her. That was the easy bit. It was all the other you had to do with in between time. You sort of I struggled to deal with.
And Luke Nolan takes her down the track in front of this enormous crowd.
I get remembered for it, you know, I'll be remembered forever in racing circles because of Black Caviar.
There is Black Caviar. Look at Luke Nolan riding so confidently near the line.
One thing I did appreciate about it was just how hard it is to find a good horse. This spring, I'm most looking forward to riding I Wish I Win.
I wish I win too good.
He's not unlike me, he's a bit no frills, he's no fuss, so we probably suit each other pretty good.
I Wish I Win over the top. We look to be struggling, but makes it easy at the end.
Our goal being the Everest, so yeah, can't wait for it. Can't wait.
I Wish I Win's going to absolutely pound them into the turf.
I won't swap mine for any of them. I'm very happy with where my bloke is, and I can't wait.
I want to be out on the open road.
There's plenty of fire left. I love riding. I love horses. I've done this job since I was 15, 16 years old. I haven't done anything else. Each time I've had a bad fall or a bad injury, I've had a chance to take stock and ask myself what else do I do, and I haven't come up with anything yet. So we're in it for at least the short term and hopefully the long term.
Oh, he's a character, isn't he, Luke Nolan? And he's used to high pressure, of course, after his association with the unbeaten Black Caviar. We're going to get to a break here on The Everest Show. More to come after that.
Still to come on The Everest Show, Emily and Guy go head-to-head on the punt, and it's not pretty.
You can throw the six in if you want. I'm not telling you what to do.
We get down with ACC.
Let's really pick at the scab of the Trans-Tasman rivalry here with the top five Trans-Tasman sporting incidents.
And BP's back in black.
Bang!
Well, Guy, here's what we've got for you. A $100 betting voucher for you.
Thank you so much.
$100 betting voucher for me. But there's a catch. First four races at Matamata, we're going to pick winners from the yard. No race book, no form, no jockeys, no info. We're going to use everything we learnt this morning, put it to the test.
I have been stitched up here, but I am willing to give it a go.
Got to be in to win.
Absolutely, let's do it.
Very careful to make sure you've seen them all. Four's just walked in under our radar.
Yep.
Great big walk. See, yep. It's striding yep. across there. Look at four over there.
Very good. So what are we doing now?
Four to win, nine to place.
I'll do 10 to win on number 3 and number 11, please.
First on the guard, Jake's open, they're off, and racing at the 200, Summer Bear judge, dashed away here by four, Stokes is walking up, followed
come on,
by
Stokes.
Son of Summer, over the inside,
come on, Stokes.
Judge, but Summer near, and Joe Dorn so are on the line at front here.
What a start. Hello, 125 bidding boxes.
Here we go, it's $5,
sorry, had to.
Absolute stitch up.
So the 11 here is really appealing to me. It's got lots of leg under it. It's got a nice long leg, big frame. Yeah, bright. The coat's reasonably good.
I'm at the 2. I quite liked the 2.
Yep, 2's nice.
Well, Emily, I'm going to go at the 2. I quite liked the shiny coat, and it's kind of looks ready to race.
I'm going 11 and 5.
Okay, good luck.
It's power time.
Go!
The lead from the bottom is coming into it. Still there, Thunderhill. Bending away to the floor.
Go!
It's power time. It's Sam Wiggly in front going towards the line. Power time is good. Second coppers to the floor.
That's glorious. This is good stuff.
Should we quit now whilst we're ahead?
No, absolutely not. I back the winner. Game is too easy, mate.
They're no good, are they?
I'll try them. Always try them.
Okay.
There's no point. Why does 3 have 2?
Because it maybe would be a bit of a handful if it were only
And is that
one.
An issue?
No. What have you got?
I think I'm going to 4.
Okay, I'm going 2 again, 7 and 3.
Okay, best of luck.
Dabblad will win it. Luxuriant finding the line late will take second ahead of Marcelo, then came down.
Oh, well, can't win them all.
At least we've had a win each.
Absolutely.
I've got your funds down a bit. That's excellent.
There's still a chance.
I'm not telling you anything this time. I'm not even... No advice.
No, that's fine.
You're on your own now.
You're the pro.
Oh, shut up. I don't need to be like that. Have you got any advice for me?
Well, the one has just walked out and looks...
It's got a bit of presence,
quite striking about
yeah.
itself. Righto, Sweens, Emily doesn't know I'm talking to you. I'm cheating the system a little bit. Help me out in terms of one that I should back.
I think in race number 4, there's a horse called Valentine. Should run on speed. Now, the money's gone on. That's always a big lead from the Te Akau team, and you'd think Opie would sit right up on speed. It's not overly long. A guy at $2.70, but it's got a lot of positive factors around it with the way the track should run on one Opie Boston.
$2.70 will be a nice little finish, mate, so that sounds bloody good. But man, that one is beautiful.
Yep, looks really well. Fit?
Very fit.
1, 2, 3, 8. I think the Turn Me Loose will win this.
Is that the one?
Yeah.
We're both on that.
Yeah, it looked beautiful in there.
And I've gone 10 and 6, and you went...
I'm on 2 and 4.
At the 150, led by a half length, coming after now, solid out wide in Cinnamon, but the favourite time, Valentine. Valentine will be too good. Second at the line will be Fonzie. Third photos, solid and out wide, Cinnamon.
For God's sake, I've had it with you today. Seriously.
Four races down, Emily, how did you go?
Are you trying to be patronising?
I'm just asking a question.
So, I've got 108. Betting voucher. Positives,
profit.
I haven't lost any money. Negatives are, show us your result.
228, you little beauty.
That's it. I'm out.
Okay, I do have one thing to tell you. I may or may not have called Bevan Sweeney for a little tip, but he only gave me a tip on the last.
Are you kidding me? Oh, I actually feel so much better. That's actually made me feel so much better. I'm not as bad as I thought.
He didn't help me with race 2, though. Yeah.
Oh, I tell you what, sneaky. Hey. And the Zoom call, the whole package. Now I've seen what actually went on.
Had a little sausage roll with me as well. It was a great little stopover at the cafe.
You did well, to be fair, all jokes aside. Yeah, for yeah.
I promise you,
really
you the last
well.
Race was the only race he helped me in. I promise
I
you that.
I believe him
but
anymore.
Also, yeah. Your teaching, and I'm not just saying this because you're here, but your teaching was, I learned so much that day, actually, about the difference between a sprinter and a stayer, and it did actually help, obviously.
Yeah, clearly, too much.
Surely Opie should have just said, hey, you know.
Well, I was doing the game, legitimately playing the game that we set up.
He probably did.
Well, I would have had more winners, had he? Surely, wouldn't I? We're going to leave that. We're going to bench that. My ego, very much dented. We've had a lot of fun with the ACC over the past couple of weeks, and they are back with us. Let's find out what they got for us this week.
Thanks, team. Hey, listen, Manai, I think Emily really is carrying this panel, to be honest. The other guys look a little bit out of their depth, particularly Hevelt.
Perhaps we can jack his seat up or something. All right, not long now till the Everest, the richest race in Australasia. $20 million on the line, and we plan to crap on the party from a massive height with I Wish I Win. Look, let's really pick at the scab of the Trans-Tasman rivalry here with the top 5 Trans-Tasman sporting incidents.
Number 1. The good old underarm, the classic sporting incident, the go-to Trevor Chappell, yeah, under instruction from his loser older brother Greg, bowled the last delivery at the MCG in 1981 along the ground. Of course, the moral victory was Bruce Ecker at the other end, Manai, 102 not out. And as that ball was delivered, he just gave the two-fingered salute to Trev. So moral victory for New Zealand.
Just cameras sucked back then, didn't they? Number 2. George Gregan versus Jeff Wilson, 1994. The ABs come back to win the game. Goldie, he steps one. Dummies, steps another. Dives for the line when time's up on the clock and dirty old 4 more years comes out of nowhere. Might have been the last time the Aussies win the Bledisloe.
Number 3. New Zealand sinking 1-1 in the America's Cup.
on the Hodaki Gulf in 1995 with a torpedo, apparently, Manaya. And within minutes of hitting it, one Australia is headed to the bottom of the Hodaki Gulf to swim with the snappers. Oh, dingoes flying off the boat. Look at them.
Number four. Geordie versus the MCG Boxing Day Test. The only All Black to be sent off at a rugby match and at a cricket match at the MCG. He biffed his beer and then was biffed out. Very un-Australian.
Very un-Australian. Come on. Number five. Scott Styris v. Mitchell Johnson. The helmet headbutt. 2010. The Caketon in Wellington. Scott the Pig Styris smears Mitchell Johnson to the boundary for four. Mitchell not happy about it, then proceeds to headbutt Styris. One thing though, Manaya, Styris has got a helmet on. What a helmet.
Oh, it's always a good laugh, isn't it, with the ACC? And I am looking forward to guys seeing what they got for us next week. It's always entertaining.
Yeah, they're seemingly ramping up, so I'm a little bit scared about what's coming for the last week.
The finale, what's it going to be? Well, Brendan Popplewell, he is not an egg, but he cracked it last week and got us home in front with his betting tips. And we're back to the betting lab. We're leaning on you hard this week, Brendan. Can you deliver again?
Yes, well, hope so. I really like it. And a couple of different bets this week. I'm going with the Cornella, first of all, in the Team Whelan's Matamata Cup, because we've got these two great horses lining up. Both Group 1 winners, both terrific mares, La Creek and Legato. They were scratched from last week's Arrowfield Plate due to the heavy track conditions. They face off in a listed race over 1,600 metres at Matamata, taking the Cornella with both of these runners in that race. Then we're going to go with the multi. First of all, we're going to have this horse here. This is Prowess. She's won a Vinery Stud Group 1 in Australia. She also won a Group 1 here in New Zealand in a Bone Crusher Stakes against the older horses. She returns, so she might be vulnerable. So I'm looking at the place bet for her in that top three market where she's around $1.25. Looking forward to seeing this horse. This is Romantic Warrior. He is the favourite for the Cox Plate at $3.50. He takes his place in the Turnbull Stakes on the weekend. James McDonald aboard. He's won two Group 1s aboard this runner in Hong Kong. He is a real exciting horse. He might be a good place bet as well in this race to Turnbull Stakes, a race that has delivered year on year in terms of Caulfield Cup, Cox Plate and Melbourne Cup horses. So this is the bet we're going to go with. $100 multi, La Creek top four at $1.50. Yes, that is a top four price for La Creek. Yes, she's got 60 kilos, but $1.50 to run in the first four, I thought was great money. Prowess top three, $1.25, and Romantic Warrior top three at $1.30. Then we'll go to the Matamata Cup, $100 Cornella, Legato and La Creek. Fingers crossed we can get some more money back in the bin. We've still left with $252 after last week's result, so yeah, here's hoping we've got something there for us.
Well, we've got faith in you, Brendan, after last week. And what about the quality horse flesh on display over the weekend here in New Zealand and, of course, Australia as well? Last week, we told you about a competition. It was win a trip for two to the Everest. And we do have our winner, can announce it on the show. It's not Guy Haveld, but it is Ashley and Amu Atutahi. Well done to you. You are off to the Everest. We hope you can belt out an edition of Sweet Caroline in the build-up to one of the greatest races on the calendar.
Learn the lyrics.
Yeah, learn the lyrics. Start of the show. Rewind. You can learn it from that. We also obviously want to remind you as to where to watch the Everest. If you want premier coverage, head to Trackside Premier, Sky Channel 64 and TVNZ+. We're going to be bringing you exclusive action from Randwick, Caulfield and Hastings, the best of the best. We've got great quality teams, not only across the Tasman, but here in New Zealand as well, to get you through all of that coverage myself. And the legendary George Simon will be part of the day. Well, that just about wraps up our show for this week. Next week is lots to look forward to, including the opportunity to win a life-changing amount of money with regards to a prize. We can tell you more about that next week. All of that to come. We also have the barrier draws, and historically, the Everest barrier draw has been something to behold. Here's a look at what they've done in previous years.
We are going to reveal the barrier draw for the $13 million TAB Everest. Tonight's barrier draw will be beamed onto the Harbour Bridge. We are in Sydney's highest peak at Sydney Tower, out on the sky deck. Bondi Beach, another iconic landmark here in Sydney. Drones have just been let go from home base.